Hey everyone, this is Brian with Ingenious Technologies. I want to thank you for your time today and joining today's webinar. Today's webinar will be done by Qualcomm, who's our partner with Ingenious Technologies. And today's topic will be about Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 6E. I do want to add that we will answer questions at the end of this presentation. Qualcomm will answer questions at the end of this presentation. So with that said, I want to just dive right into it and hand that off over to Qualcomm today. So I want to thank you again for joining. And here you go, Qualcomm.
Knowledge. I've been working in Wi-Fi industry over 14 years. It would be my pleasure to be invited by Ingenious to talking about Wi-Fi 6 and 6E new Qualcomm product portfolio and offering. Thanks for your time. Today, I would like to share in the Qualcomm Wi-Fi 6E wireless to meet the moment. As a global Wi-Fi leader, we keep in driving new technology and new feature sets to make it better the network experience and make customer while using network get more satisfaction. So here we're talking about the Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 6E. So nowadays you can see that more and more Wi-Fi devices launching is already equipped the latest standard called Wi-Fi 6. So you may asking how can the acceleration run so fastly? So third party gives some kind of analyzed data. Starting from 2022, it is believed that Wi-Fi 6 device annually comes shipping 1 billion units. And among exactly the same year, the whole new devices would take 56% up the market share, they'll be go with the Wi-Fi 6. Moving beyond 2024, we believe that Wi-Fi 6 will be the de facto Wi-Fi standard. So check it again, the current the user scenario for the networking everybody so far. Majority of the network applications so far people using is high intense bandwidth. For example, like a video conference call, is no longer to be like a single direction, now it's a bi-direction. So immersed upon products like IoT devices, also the gaming, bunch of things you can see that surrounding nearby you and I daily life. So even in a household, more and more the Wi-Fi traffic, we deeply rely on top of that. And you can imagine how densely the environment so far we're facing. How are we gonna working do this? Firstly, Wi-Fi feature, we introduce the multi-user capacity. The way we Qualcomm introduced a universal uplink, downlink support in MU-MIMO and OFDMA by dynamic scheduling, we can easily further analyze the data packet and give suitable feature set to enhance the spectrum efficiency and gain performance. Same time, by channel bonding on Wi-Fi 6, upscale to 160 megahertz the channel to increase the capacity, which will be easier to get the multi-gig performance over the air. Qualcomm offer the configuration tied offering for the Wi-Fi 6 feature sets and availability to driving scalable products globally, make Wi-Fi with the Wi-Fi 6 feature sets run everywhere. So let's take a little bit deeper for Wi-Fi 6 feature set. The first one, OFDMA. This give a quick example would be help everybody to understand a little bit these terms. Imagine you had a bunch of a small packet with you. It would be easy. You just put already everything into a trunk, go to the same destination. Similar situation has been leveraged on the Wi-Fi 6 networking. So by packet, the 10 small packets and run to the access point, which can maximize the bandwidth with efficiency. As for MU MIMO, this is not a new feature actually. Starting from the Wi-Fi 5, we already introduced the MU MIMO. The question here is more and more the data is bi-directional. It's not only downlink, even uplink, the data is quite a bandwidth loading. So you need uplink MU MIMO to well addressing the performance issue. So let's take an example on the current real world situation. Majority, the client simply is a lower the transmit power compared with the access point traditionally. So by adopting the Wi-Fi 6, multiple client can tidy bundling as a packet and send it over to the access point. You can see that the spectrum is being well efficiently saved. Uplink or DNA will better improve the uplink downlink imbalance between access point and client. I have a prepared video. So by comparing non-uplink MU MIMO single user competitive solution versus Qualcomm networking port with fast connection client devices, you can see that more than 2 times the better performance can be achieved. So let's take a look at the video. Everybody knows that it is really like a 2.4 times better by enable uplink MU MIMO versus standalone devices without uplink MU MIMO. Real world, a lot of the data with a small package, for example, like text notification, like voice. Also, as I just mentioned, like conference room, video streaming, and also you may have a heavy data needed to sync on the cloud. Or DNA would be more suitable for the small packets. MU MIMO in general would be more suitable for the big data. However, it would be tough for an end user to try to identify which feature set we're gonna use. So dynamic scheduling before data transferring, they will further investigate data package and choose the suitable feature set, for example, ORFDNA or MU MIMO to meet every data and gain efficiency and performance. So further on, will on the go network environment only Wi-Fi 6 device? No, everybody know that. Imagine, okay, let's take a look at the size. It's putting a mask on the mountain side. Yeah, pretty much the same situation like current networking environments mixed with the legacy device as well as the Wi-Fi 6 device. So without the multi-user feature sets, legacy device just pass over all the data once a time. by introducing mu MIMO and RFDNA, you can get better the usage of spectrum, whether duplicate the transmission like mu MIMO or run at the time by package more the package duty once. Still, we're expecting that if there is a brand new spectrum, by offering the OFDNA and mu MIMO simply using a new spectrum, we believe that that will be further better enhance the network congestion situation. So this idea, we talking about the Wi-Fi 6E, which is bringing the Wi-Fi 6 on the go feature set extending to 6E spectrum. But this kind of idea, firstly, you can gain the benefits for capacity. By taking US as an example, by enable 6E, you have a 1.2 gig spectrum wider than traditional 2.4 and 5G, which means that you have more channel could be taken advantage. By introduce a new spectrum management and leverage new size survey algorithm, 6G band would keep us efficiency and clean as possible. Offering up to 7/160 channel, multi-gig performance with ultra low latency will be further be enhanced on the 6G band to gain better the performance. So later on, I would like to let our Qualcomm engineer VP VK to give a quick introduction 6G band benefits in the congestion area compared with the 5G.
We are at an interesting point in the history of Wi-Fi. For 20 years or so, we've been working with the same spectrum that the FCC allocated. We published a paper about that and sort of rallied the industry around approaching the FCC to see if they'd be interested in offering more 6 gigahertz spectrum. Qualcomm's been hard at work building implementations to address this spectrum. Specifically, we've been working to bring Wi-Fi 6E technology into this band. Wi-Fi 6E is the name that the Wi-Fi Alliance is using for the new features that will be implemented in the 6 gigahertz band. And we will be bringing 160 megahertz channels, new security, multi-user architecture, and we'll be bringing our latency enhancements that we introduced as part of Wi-Fi 6. We wanted to show the real value of 6 gigahertz. This is a real-world demo. It's over the air. It's in a crowded environment. And what you'll get to see is how the new Wi-Fi 6E devices avoid all of the existing congestion on 5 gigahertz and operate in a clean 160 megahertz channel in 6 gigahertz. This is an over-the-air, open-space demo that shows a smartphone product design, and it features our Qualcomm FastConnect subsystem. And on the access point side, this is a Wi-Fi router based on our Qualcomm networking Pro Series platform. So what you're seeing today are not just prototypes, there are actual reference designs with our production chips in them. And that allows us to provide, you know, to a phone multi-gigabit per second, be able to provide much higher throughputs that you will see in dense environments like enterprise environments and in public spaces. Well, the new spectrum will bring a whole new set of use cases. Wi-Fi has a bright future. You can see more from Qualcomm in the years to come.
Everybody know that in US, 6G spectrum has already enabled and also has commercial products launching. Also, we got Korea has a 6G products under launching, and more other four countries are close ready to launch in the 6G spectrum. Through the whole global map, we can tell that up to 26 countries and beyond is under developing and approval the 6G spectrum. It is believed that the Wi-Fi 6E gonna be coming. So recap again. So in the 6G, you simply can get this 7 channel with the up to 160 megahertz, the bandwidth, comparing with the 5G, only have a two channel. Most importantly, 6G band does not have a DFS requirement. So it will be more easy to get the gigabit performance. I just mentioned that the new network discovering has been introduced on the 6G band. Imagine that if a client has to connect in already doing a site survey on the 2G and 5G, access point can push in the client to the 6G band. The manager friend can keep in the latency band 2.4 and 5G and leave the 6G band with the clean, less management plan as possible. There is no need for a station to scan the whole 6G spectrum. The scan channel will only take 25% of the whole 6G spectrum. Again, I think that that will be either get the efficient networking for the 6G band. The other thing would make networking more conjunction and less latency. That will be once if a client ran into multiple access point scenario. Here we take example like office scenario or maybe airport scenario. Bunch of access point may leverage same channels. If a client would like to connect to an access point, just simply send a proper request to whole access point within channel. Traditionally, they need to wait in line and to get the transmit signal and do the data transferring. Somehow that will be make the latency be sacrificed. The introduce of BSS color with a 6-bit random code being assigned to each SSI BSS. For this scenario, the client can simply ignore the OBSS packet if the color is not at the same group and can keep the connection as and transfer delivering as it is, which further improves the efficiency for the whole network environment. So Qualcomm offering the new Tri-Band solution equipped with the 2.4 and 5 and extending to 6G band. 6G will be more straightforward for the dedicated backhaul and further by connecting with the Qualcomm client solution, fast connecting and can further the performance enhancement by upspeed the modulation from 1K QAM to 4K QAM. So imagine the mesh system here we're talking about. 5G band on the go, they have a two role need to take care. The first one will be the front hole that will be supplying the collision, client solution. Same time, they will spare the resource for the backhaul. But this kind of a mesh system performance and stability, which is better than the traditional standalone router, but still have a conjunction you can tell on the 5G. By introduce the 6G band, 5G band will be clean and move the backhaul to 6G band will significantly reduce the conjunction and gain the throughput and make a mesh network system more stable. Qualcomm offering a series of products equipment with the Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 6E. Here we're talking about the Qualcomm networking transceivers, It is a platform is building to lead the industry with the Wi-Fi 6 and 6E feature sets. It is advanced chipset architecture optimized for high density the environments. Inside of that, the maximum capacity can reach up to 16 in the spectrum stream. For the OFDNA, can support up to 37 users, and NU MIMO can up to 8 users support at the same time. Per access point can support up to 2,000 user connection. Previously, we discussing the multi-user offering and scheduling algorithm or being equipped. I think that the engineers also done this platform and make a product launch. Move beyond to offer a scalable, more cost budget solution, we introduce Qualcomm Immersive Phone platform. Simply, if you're looking for the ultra smaller design or inward smaller the phone factor, Immersive Phone platform would be more suitable. Comparing with the PCB size, you can tell the networking port and Immersive Phone. I think that would be almost like a 25% the space saving. It is not a sacrifice the wireless speeds. Comparing with the Wi-Fi 5 mesh system, Immersive Phone still run 2 times better than Wi-Fi 5 mesh system, comparing with the competitor solution. Also, is far beyond 2 times better than competitor Wi-Fi 6 solution. By comparing with the competitor Wi-Fi 6 solution, Qualcomm Immersive Phone still ran 2 times better than competitor Wi-Fi 6 solution. Overall, Immersive Phone bring more power efficiency. Through the bar, you can tell it would be ultra low cost with the ultra low power comparing with the Qualcomm networking port series. So Wi-Fi 6E is delivering better Wi-Fi connection everywhere. Qualcomm has a fragment shift networking port series till cost economic immersive phone platform. We bring the advanced Wi-Fi 6E feature and supporting oligo conjunction the networking environments. Qualcomm technology is ready, scalable offering for every environment. Appreciate your time and attention today. Thank you, engineers, to have me.
Thank you, Mei-Wei. That was thanks for the great information around Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 6E. That was really great information. We're really excited at Ingenious to be able to offer a Wi-Fi 6E solution. So what we'll do is we'll open it up for any questions that you may have. We have Ganesh from the Senior Director of Product Management at Qualcomm to help answer any questions that you may have. Go ahead. If you have any questions, by all means, let us know, please. Thanks. Try to use the Q&A section of the Zoom meeting or webinar to answer any questions, and I'll try to do that. All right. So first question, what case studies are available for Wi-Fi 6 in education, school districts? That's really, I think Eddie Lee, you're also on. Again, this is Brian with Ingenious. So case studies, we have actually multiple case studies. We're working on a Wi-Fi 6 and education case study right now. So that will be available soon. But Ingenious has deployed Wi-Fi into many education scenarios, but we will have a Wi-Fi 6 case study in education coming out here very shortly. So look out for that. So Wi-Fi 6 has been a great solution offering that we've had available for some time. So it's really helped us in a lot of situations because it's dealing with, it's providing higher efficiency communication. So it's been very helpful. The other question is, will this be also part of the E-rate category? Yes, it already is. I believe there's already cases out there that Wi-Fi 6 is being deployed in these different scenarios. What we have found are a lot of schools are transitioning over to Wi-Fi 6 because it's, you know, it's a needed upgrade with all the devices that are going into these types of environments. Any other questions? Is Ingenious and Qualcomm in partnership in delivering the solutions? Yeah, we are. We've been a long time Qualcomm partner and been using that solution and all of our access points, all of our wireless devices, quite honestly. And so we are in partnership and we do work hand in hand in delivering a solution to our customer base. If you're not aware, we were one of the first companies to deploy Wi-Fi 6 into the SMB space and saw great success there. So we look forward to offering Wi-Fi 6E as well, hopefully this year. That's our intent. But yeah, great question.
Hey, Brian, I see the question about the channel. Maybe I can talk about
that. Oh, yeah,
that.
Of course, yep.
So some people have a question regarding the 5 gigahertz and 6 gigahertz channel, right? So so just to let you guys know, the 5 gigahertz, 20 megahertz, 40 megahertz, all the way to 160 megahertz. For 20 megahertz, we have you can support up to a 9. For 40 megahertz, you only have 4 channel you can use. And 80 megahertz, even you can only have 2. So, but the 6 gigahertz, the total channel can be utilized is 109. So 20 megahertz, you have 59 channel you can be used. 40 megahertz, you have 29 channel can be used. So, and also even 80 megahertz, you have 14 channel can be used. So that's a lot more channel compared to 5 gigahertz. So especially for the large deployment and like a school campus or a hotel. So that would be really beneficial for those deployment. And again, this the advantage of a Wi-Fi 6 in 6 gigahertz is you have a greater spectrum, right? You reduce the congestion and overhead and lower latency. Most important, you enable the full performance of Wi-Fi 6. Like I said, you have a great number of the channel, significant more wide channel can be used on the 6 gigahertz. So yeah, hope that helped you to answer the question. So
yeah, and I'll add to that as well, Eddie, because we run into this question a lot where in a lot of cases where you are trying to get more bandwidth, you want to go to like an 80 megahertz channel. That's typically what you want to do in regards to like an access point when you're deploying. But when you go beyond 2 access points, that's when you have to really restrict the channel widths down to about, you know, 40 megahertz. And in high density areas, you have to even go down to 20 megahertz. So with Wi-Fi 6E, I mean, that really builds a case for now I can use more 160 megahertz channels, even 80 megahertz channels. So yeah, it opens the door. There's a lot of spectrum. When you look at the graphics of, you know, or pictures of Wi-Fi 6E and how much more spectrum it gives you, it's really impressive. So that's the one thing I've noticed when looking at that, how many 160 megahertz channels that they're offering and 80. So this is a really great thing that that 6E will offer us, right? So So thanks, Eddie, for adding that. There's kind of a comment, kind of question. Not really seeing too many Wi-Fi networks with overcongested 5 gigahertz. Rather, outdoor fixed wireless 5 gigahertz is where the overcrowding is. So is there a focus in this space? Eddie, did you want to answer that? Or I can try to answer that as well.
Oh, go ahead, Brian.
Yeah, so that's actually not the case. That's not our experience anyway. I'm not saying that's not the case, but that's not our experience. Where we see overcongestion with 5 gigahertz is definitely in the indoor space. When you go beyond a certain AP count, when you're in the 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 access point count within a space and they're being vertically stacked within maybe the hospitality industry, multifamily units, you do start to run out of channels. And so then you start to run into interference, right, as well. So you have to be really, really cautious within the indoor space and your channelization. So Wi-Fi 6E would really open that up in these indoor more larger deployments, I would say, in education, hospitality, multifamily units. We do see it also in 5 outdoor fixed wireless as well. So there will be a focus in that space. So yeah, you will see that in the outdoor space as well. So indoor and outdoor, so on both. It's going to help us. So let's see. So I think Ganesh has joined us. So I want to thank Ganesh for helping with any of the Q&A that we have from Qualcomm. So there was a question. Hi, Ganesh.
Hey.
There is a question around 6E. What kind of range will 6E have? Will we see, is this coverage in a one-room scenario or multi-room? Will it be similar to 5G in regards to how the frequency will travel? We know six gigahertz could be shorter, but the question is, how far will it travel, or do we have an idea of that?
Yeah, so I can certainly give some color on that. First of all, thanks for inviting me, having me here. So hopefully you guys had a great webinar so far. Specifically on this question, you rightfully said, as the frequency increases, obviously there's an effect on range. That's just physics, right? So for all things being equal, 2.4 gig is better than 5, better than 6, right? So that's kind of how the equation goes. Now, that being said, in 6 gigahertz, there are some other factors that need to be looked at. Because of how the rules of engagement have been written and standardized. There is this element of, a 6 gigahertz is a 1.2 gig spectrum. So obviously there are certain incumbents in there. So the FCC and other regulatory bodies are looking at, what is considered, LPI or low power indoor operation, very low power, and then going towards a standard called, the standard power operation with AFC, where you have to have some kind of a cloud-based GPS orientation thing, where you can then say how much power can an access point located in a particular geo can actually operate on. So those are some of the new elements that are coming in, kind of like what happened in CBRS, but in Wi-Fi it's new. So then there's also the notion of bandwidth, right? You go from 40, 80, and now at 160, in the 6 gigahertz technology rollout, obviously the higher the bandwidth, then it also helps you. So long story short, so if you compare what's approved in regulations today, which is the low power indoor operation, there is, reduction in terms of the amount of output power that can be put out by an access point running on 6 gigahertz, as well as clients running on 6 gigahertz. What that means is apples to apples today, 5 gig with a high power FEM can push up to 36 dBm EARP. Comparatively, a 4x4 160 Wi-Fi 6E will be somewhere in the 27 to 30 dBm EARP. So there is a difference between what 6 gigahertz range, especially as you look at the far end of the RVR curve, there will be a difference, and 5 gig at this point would do a little bit better, all things being equal. Once the static power gets approved next year, that's the target. You know, there will be opportunities for the 6 gigahertz to come up to the same level as 5, and then with the wider spectrum provide you, you know, up to 7 160 megahertz channels. So in that sense, 6 gigahertz is going to quickly overtake what 5 gigahertz capacity and will be equal on the range. So that's the promise, and that's it's coming, right? It's just a matter of time that these regulations get approved. The serviceness, the serviceability of this, you know, the standard power operation needs to, all the infrastructure needs to get settled down, but otherwise, you know, we believe it's happening. So that's the thing, right? For this year, for the next 12 months, Wi-Fi 6E from a range point of view will be slightly limited compared to 5 gig, but the bandwidth is going to help compensate, because if you're looking at, you know, a medium range operation, the 160 megahertz bandwidth is still going to come in and help you. If you're really focused on far end, then yeah, it's going to show some limitations, which will be addressed in the next 12 months when the standard power gets approved.
Great. Thank you for that. That was great. another question. So this is a three question from one individual. So I'll start with the first one. DFS is not required for 6 gigahertz in parentheses in Europe, just AFC?
Correct. That's correct. So DFS is not being called out, you know, but there is the AFC rules and regulations that we need to talk about. And that's where the standard power operation I mentioned in the previous question.
Got it. Yep.
So that needs to be addressed. And that's where different countries or different geos have come up with different rules. In Europe, you know, the entire 1.2 gig spectrum is not opened up. Only the first half of it is. Right. So, and even there, obviously, there are some regulations with respect to what the max power can be and how the AFC need to come in. So this is going to be an evolving thing. Different countries approve, you know, some or all of the spectrum. So we need to kind of work through that.
Gotcha. Actually, I think you answered all three of the questions. So let's move on. Okay. Is the, let's see. Is the power requirement going to increase, I guess, for 6 gigahertz when you're using 6 gigahertz, I guess?
Power requirement, you mean, so it won't be, it will be increased compared to, let's say, if you're using low power indoor operation and its output power as a baseline. Yes, as we go towards a standard power with AFC, the goal is to bring the output power and parity to, let's say, what a 5 gigahertz solution can do today at the ERP level. So that has always been the goal. It's just that the nature of the incumbents on the 6 gigahertz spectrum, we had to plan for it as the unlicensed spectrum operations comes through, and then who are the incumbents and what kind of standard power methodologies we need to employ to ensure that we don't go and, you know, disrupt the incumbents today. Right, that's the whole idea. So yes, standard power will bring in increased power capabilities to the 6 gigahertz LPI situation from today.
Great. Another question, will all 6E devices be tri-band, or will we get a 6 gigahertz only device that can be mixed with current Wi-Fi 6 APs?
Yeah, that's a tricky question. On the client side, yes, there's going to be, obviously, everybody's going to support a tri-band and selectable. It's a no-brainer on the client side. On the access point side, it's a bit tricky. We see, you know, a vast majority of the access point providers looking at it as a tri-band solution. I think, you know, that's why, you know, you would probably see a lot of interest at two different tiers of the product set, a really high-end product that delivers on performance and also a more mainstream product that delivers on cost, because you're attaching a third radio to deliver that value of 6 gigahertz. There are discussions about can one of the bands be, you know, selectable between 5 versus 6. You know, those implementations do come with a lot of challenges. And also you need to look at what your deployment model is and how you want to service those clients. How do you want to service, you know, what kind of channel switching, so to speak, or band switching times that you're willing to live with. What happens if you're servicing a 5 gigahertz client of certain nature, and then now you have a request coming in on the 6 gigahertz, and if you don't have a deployment with a tri-band capability, now you will be switching between 5 and 6. And depending on the traffic that's ongoing in either of the bands, you know, you may not be doing the right service to either of those clients. So this is one of the reasons why the access point guys have been looking at 6 more as a tri-band, not necessarily as a selectable 5-6 band.
Thank you for that. And do you see more client devices supporting 160 megahertz now in the mobile device area? Do you see that happening?
Absolutely. And I think everybody wants to get the highest bandwidth, right? Especially in the mobile device, it's very difficult to fit in more number of chains. So things have to be driven by the amount of bandwidth. So bandwidth also can deliver you the performance that you need at the range that you need, right? So I, you know, every device will move to 160 megahertz operation. I mean, I think largely they've already moved, but with the ones that are missing, unless they are done for a very cost sensitive reason, technology-wise, there will be a push, and there is already a push towards supporting the highest bandwidth, which is 160 today.
Thank you. Another question here. Will 6 gigahertz be open to other non-Wi-Fi devices to use as ISM is today, I guess?
If that makes sense. Yet to be seen. So at this point, we know about what 6 gigahertz is used for on the current incumbents as well as now Wi-Fi. We have still a path ahead or a long road ahead to ensure that Wi-Fi, you know, with 6 gigahertz is fully regulated, gets to the highest power levels possible to deliver, you know, even higher value at the highest spectrum. So we still have a little bit, you know, journey left on Wi-Fi itself. So I would think that the industry is obviously focusing on that and getting it done, whether it's going to be open beyond Wi-Fi. I don't have enough information to say, yeah, it's going to happen for these things, right? I would probably, you know, need some time to understand where the industry is going before commenting on that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Let's see. A lot of questions I'm trying to go through here. Let's see. Will any of the Qualcomm Wi-Fi 6E chip solution allow APs to do spectrum analysis? I think I already know that answer, but Ganesh, I'll let you answer that question if you want to.
Sure. I mean, we have been doing spectrum analysis for a long time now. So yes, there's no, you know, no difference. You know, we've been doing this since, you know, last few, I would say more than 5 years now. On every chip supports, you know, inline channel scan, spectrum analysis. And if you care for adding a dedicated radio, we support that for Wi-Fi 5 as well as now with the 6 and 6E. There are scanned radio options available if you prefer to have that as a separate radio. So both options exist. And doing an inline spectrum scan and shared time slot between data and scanning, or dedicated scanned radio on top of the existing chipsets. Both are supported.
Perfect. Thank you. Questions come up basically for Ingenious in regards to Wi-Fi 6 E, if we will have a solution. Yes, we will have a solution that will, I believe, will launch this year. I can't go into really any details on that, but yes, we will have a solution, a cloud solution specifically for Wi-Fi 6 E. So yeah, we will definitely have something this year. There's another question. When will the first 6E be introduced? I think that's already been introduced, but Ganesh, if you want to comment on that.
Sorry, what was the specific question?
When will the first 6E device be introduced?
Yeah, so there's already a lot of announcements at the industry level. From Qualcomm, there has been an announcement with our partner in North America. So I think that's public news. And of course, as the engineers team said, you know, there's product plans of bringing out some products down the road. But you would see commercial products-wise in retail, obviously, some product announcements have happened. We would anticipate, you know, as we go towards summer and fall, more and more access points, retail, and possibly, you know, even at enterprise level, there's a lot of work happening because 6E definitely is a value for the enterprise customers because it's a new swath of spectrum. ability to finally deploy potentially in 80 megahertz and 160 megahertz, right? Today, they've been largely deploying 20 and 40. So 6E gives them the opportunity to push towards 80 and maybe even at 160, depending on the capability and the channel availability. So yeah, you will see a lot of enterprise launches beginning, I would say, fall this year as well.
Thank you for that. quick question, Eddie, if you're still on, this probably question is really directed towards you. In regards to, will there be a version of the in-station with Wi-Fi 6E?
Yeah, that's a good question. So we will have the Wi-Fi 6E point-to-point solution. Like Brian mentioned, the in-station AC, the form factor, but with Wi-Fi 6E solution. But in regards to schedule, we cannot disclose this. It's coming.
There's plans for it, basically.
Yep.
Okay. All right, perfect. Okay, I think I covered all the questions. I'm just combing through really quick. I believe we covered everything. I think with that, I want to thank Qualcomm. I want to thank you, Ganesh, for jumping on and answering questions. It's always great to have you on. You're so you. There's a lot of knowledge there that, you know, we always want to have like on our webinars. So we really appreciate you being on. We want to thank you for your time. We know you're a very busy person, but we want to thank you for your time and joining us today.
No problem. Thank you very much for having me, and I'm glad to help in whatever way or shape you and your customers. So much appreciated.
Yeah, thank you. I want to thank everybody for attending today. It was a great pleasure. I want to thank Mei Wei again for presenting today's material. So that was a lot of great information. So I want to thank the Qualcomm team for helping us put on this webinar, and I want to thank everybody for joining, and thank you for all your time. With that said, we'll go ahead and sign off. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, guys.